Welcome to you all in EPG Pathshala. Myself, Dr. Muhammad Nazrul Bari, associated with the Department of History, Central University of Karnataka. In the last module, we discuss about the society and culture of Sultanate period, that was from 13th to 16th century. In that modules, we have discussed about the contribution which was made by the Sultanate rulers in the field of art, architecture, the development which took place mainly in Persian and Arabic language, and the patronage which was given for the development of regional language by the different regional kings and sultans. Now here we will discuss about the society and culture that deals with the Mughal period. For this chapter we have certain objectives, and the objectives are to understand the socio-cultural life of people under Mughal Empire. Next, to find out the contribution of Mughal ruler and their nobles in the existing social life of India. Then to get the idea about the condition of women. Then to know the role of Mughal ruler and their nobles in the development of painting, music, language and literature. And the last, to evaluate the contributions of Mughal rulers in architectural development in India. Here, first we will focus on society and culture. During Mughal period, we saw the important socio-cultural development. Many European travelers, including Bernier, Manucci, Thomas Rowe, those who visited India at the time of Mughals, they left a wonderful description about the socio-cultural condition of India. Also, they described on the wealth and prosperity of India and the luxurious life of the aristocratic class, mainly the ruling class, sultans, nobles, emperors. On the other side, they also make mention about the poverty and suffering of the ordinary people, such as peasants and artisans. Montserrat stated that Lahore in 1581 was not second to any city in Europe or Asia, while Finch, who travelled in the early days of Jahangir, found both Agra and Lahore to be much larger than London, and his testimony is supported by others also. The pivot of urban administration was Kotwal, the city governor, and he had the executive and judicial power, and it was his responsibility to prevent and detect crime and to regulate prices of the commodities during Mughal period. Bernier, writing during Aurangzeb time, declared that Hindus possessed almost exclusively the trade and wealth of the country. If Muslim enjoy advantage in higher administrative post and in the army, Hindu merchant maintained the monopoly in trade and finance, and the Hindu banker would finance his favorite rival claimant from the throne. One among such Hindu trader is Jagat Seth of Murshidabad from Bengal. Jagat Seth gave funding to Mir Qasim when there was a battle of Palasi in year 1757 between Sirajuddaula and British East India Company. And later on, Mir Qasim became Nawab after the death of Sirajuddaula. During the War of Succession in 1658-59, which Aurangzeb had with his father and brother Dara Shikoh, that time also a Jain trader gave finance of 6.5 lakh rupees to Aurangzeb so he can prepare his army to fight against the Emperor Shah Jahan. While the rural life under Mughals, Panchayat continued to settle most disputes with the state, impinging very little or village life, except for the collection of land revenue. The state advanced takavi. Takavi was basically a loan which was given for the agricultural purposes to the cultivators and occasionally provided seeds, bullocks and implements for digging wells. Now, we will give a passing reference about the agriculture also. An estimate claimed that the population of India at the beginning of the 17th century was about 125 million. Large area of land was available for cultivation, and variety of crops such as wheat, rice, gram, barley, pulses were cultivated mainly. Commercial crops such as cotton, indigo, sugar cane and oil seeds were under cultivation during the period of under study. During the 17th century, two new crops, namely tobacco and maize, were added. Potato and red chili came later in the 18th century. Now here we will focus about the dress, social customs, rites and ritual during Mughal period. Regarding the dress, the royal family and the nobility spent lot on their income on dress, which consisted of a large coat, tight trousers, turban or a cap and a silk scarf tied at the waist with the end hanging it down. The nobles also put on daggers, necklace, ear tops, sandals, etc. The dress which was more common among the people was dhoti, which was mainly for the common people, while sometime we have the reference that Muslim used pajama and kurta. Most of the people were virtually half naked. They managed to put on good cloth on festival occasion only. The dress of Hindu ladies was dhoti or sari. The Muslim women used the pajama or ghagra with kurtas. Their head dress was a scarf and they used ornaments which was equally common among male and female. Regarding the social customs, it's interesting to note that many similarities were there among the marriage custom of Hindus and Muslims. Early marriages were much in vogue amongst the Hindus, with 7 considered to be the proper age for the girl to get married. The Muslim also betrothed their children between ages of 6 and 8, but the marriages were generally not solemnized before they had attained the age of puberty. Among the wealthiest class, polygamy and divorce are said to have been very common. Polygamy means having more than one wife. The custom of secluding women, known as parda, was very strictly followed, that too mainly by the ruling class of the Muslim community. The son duty to his parent and wife duty to her husband were viewed amongst as religious obligations. Even today in 21st century, we have the same kind of situation in Indian subcontinent. Superstitions played an prominent role in the daily life of the people. Charm were used not merely to ensure a restive husband, but also to secure such other ends as the birth of a son or cure of a disease. Astrologers were very much in demand even during the Mughal court. We have lot of references that before start expedition against any enemy king, emperor of Mughal, they used to take consent of astrologers. Betel and betel nut were presented to the visitors and they were escorted with much civility at the time of departure. Dice was their favorite indoor game. Polo or chogan, for which there was a special playground at Dhaka, elephant fight, hunting, excursion and picnic were the other important popular pastime during Mughal period. Regarding the important rituals and rites, the important rites observed by the Hindu were chatti, mundan, chathavan, vidyarambha, vivah and shraddha. Chatti was a function that was on 6th day after the birth of a baby, male or female. Mundan means the shaving of head and chatavan means the taking of cereal for the first time by child. Vidyarambha means the beginning of education and biva means the marriage, and after the death, a rituals which was performed by the Hindu family was known as Shraddh. Muslims also do observe their own rites of Akikah, Bismillah, marriage ceremony and Chahallum. Akikah was a rites connected with the birth of a child. Bismillah was the beginning of education. Chahallum was a function which was after the death of their family member, after the death of 40 days of their family members. Regarding the marriage celebration, the bridegroom and his parent, accompanied by a large party, proceeded to the bride's house. The party included all the relatives of the family. Marriage party was accompanied by a band of musicians and drums and carried lamps and torches. Then henna or mehdi, which came from bride home, was applied. Next day the marriage ceremony was completed and the bridegroom was clothed in red and his face covered with sehra flower. This was almost the same method which is still used in the rural area on the marriage ceremony. A while a ceremony was on, bridegroom set almost dump both in janana and the main parts of the houses. Dance and music were in full swing. Earlier in the night, there was a display of fireworks. Then the Qazi performed the nikah ceremony, after which guests were treated to a banquet and the bride dowry was excavated outside her father's home. Now, regarding fair and festival among the Hindus, the important festival of the Hindus observed were Holi, Basant Panchami, Dashara, Diwali, Shivratri and Sankranti. Holi was celebrated by the cultivators only during Mughal period, but later on it came to be observed by all. Dashara was celebrated by all. The Kshatriya particularly worshipped their arms on this occasion. Diwali was one of the most popular festival during Mughal period, and we have the reference that even Mughal rulers do celebrate Diwali. Diwali was a festival which was more popular among the commercial community, that was Vaishya. On that occasion, the businessmen worshipped the goddess of wealth, that is goddess Lakshmi, opened their new account book. People went to places of pilgrimage such as Pushkar, Kurukshetra, Kashi, Prayag, Puri. The fair of Kumbh was also celebrated by the Hindu, who assembled in a million on that occasion. The important Muslim festival were Eid al-Zuha, Eid al-Fitr, Shab-e-Barat, Muharram and Milad-un-Nabi, which they also called Eid-e-Milad-un-Nabi. Eid al-Zuha fell on the 10th day of the last month of Islamic calendar. It was Thanksgiving celebration and animals were sacrificed on that occasion. Eid al-Fitr fell on the 1st and 10th month of Islamic calendar. While the Muharram marked the anniversary of the martyrdom of Imam Hussein, the younger son of the daughter of the Prophet, while Milad-un-Nabi or Eid-e-Milad-un-Nabi or Bar-e-Wafat was associated with the birth of Prophet Muhammad, while Nowruz was one of the festival which was celebrated by Mughal rulers, Mughal emperor with great pomp and show. This Nowruz was basically its origin in Iran and it was the New Year celebration of Parsi religion. It was usually celebrated in large garden or park on the riverside. Regarding outdoor games, we have the reference that the early Mughal emperors inherited a taste for outdoor exercise and sports. Akbar devoted a lot of time for hunting and fine riders and was able to control the fiercest elephant. Rolf Fitch, who was a traveler under Mughals, was very much impressed by the number of hawks, birds and animals maintained by Emperor Akbar. While another traveler, William Hawkins, also says that Jahangir maintained a large number of birds and he was also fond of hunting. On one occasion, he hunted continuously for 2 months and 20 days. A record was kept, as there is a reference, of the animal killed by the emperor, and Jahangir referred to as many as 17,167. Antelopes hunting was also very popular under Jahangir, and whatever paintings we have which depicts the hunting scene where king are supposed to kill the deer and antelope. It was said that killing of the lion was by the king was considered to be favorable mien, but if animal escaped, that was considered to be a sign of trouble for the future. Animal fighting was very popular with Mughal emperor and their courtiers. Elephant, buffaloes, rams and other beasts and birds took part in those contests. Foreigners were very much impressed by elephant fight. Tom Corrett tells us that twice every week elephant fight before Akbar. Akbar also fond of seeking gladiatorial context between men, and this kind of amusement was continued during the reign of Jahangir and Shah Jahan also. There were also fight between men and animal. Hawkins tells us that Jahangir ordered a Pathan to fight with the lion, and after men had been killed, he sent for 10 more men to wrestle with the beast. All the 10 were seriously wounded and 3 of them lost their lives. Polo, known as Chogan or Chogan, was introduced into India by early Mohammedan rulers of Delhi. It is well known that Qutbuddin Aibak met with his death while playing polo. Akbar was also very fond of this game. The Mughal courtiers were expected to attend regularly both to play and watch the game. Pigeon flying was also very popular during Mughal rule. It is stated that Akbar learned the art of pigeon flying from one of his tutors. Hawkins tells us that Jahangir kept a large number of birds of various kinds, including 10,000 pigeons. Pigeon fighting was a popular game with the common people. Similarly, in some part of India, we have a cock fighting as a game. Even the poor people managed to keep a few pigeon in their huts. Chase and chopper was also popular during Mughal period. Ain-e-Akbari, which was written by Abul Fazl, referred to the game was played on a cloth board in a form of a cross, each arm of the cross being divided into 24 squares into 3 rows of 8 each. This board also served the purpose of 3 other games, were named Phansa, Pachisi and Chandel Mandal. Phansa was played with dice and Pachisi was played with cowries. Now we have to focus on position of women, and we will try to evaluate what was the condition of women. Is there any improvement in compared to the previous period? So to understand the position of women, we have to find out unlike during ancient period, position of woman in a woman and their status during Mughal age was not quite high. Parda and child marriage had become common, while the birth of a daughter was considered inauspicious, while that of a son was an occasion for rejoicing. On account of early marriages, there were many widows in our society. Generally, women in Mughal period were not allowed to remarry. A Sultan Begum, Noor Jahan, Mumtaz Mahal, Chand Bibi, Jahan Ara, Roshan Ara, Jabun Nisha, etc. played an important part in the affairs of that time. Polygamy was quite common among the rich class of Hindu and Muslim both. Divorce was not common among the Hindus, while it was permitted both for Muslim men and women. If Muslim man is giving divorce to his wife, it's known as talaq, while women who do not want to stay with her husband, so she can take khola. Generally, it was responsibility of the man to look after the economic affairs and the woman would take care of the needs at home. There were many Hindu women of outstanding ability during this period, notably Rani Durgavati of Gondwana, Rani Karmavati, Mirabai, Tarabai. So in short, the position of women was almost the same as it was during Sultanate age. Now we will focus on development of architecture and art. Architecture, which had already achieved a high level of development under the Sultanate, reached to the pinnacle of its glory under the Mughals. Babur's stay in India was brief, but Constantinople pupils of the great Ottoman architect Sinan, to whom he entrusted the job of construction of mosque and other buildings in India. Akbar's most ambitious project was his new capital city and the numerous building at Fatehpur Sikri, the seat of the imperial court from 1569 to 1584. Some of his building, they were dominated by Hindu style of architecture, reflecting the emperor's regard for the Hindu religion. Persian influences were equally visible or reflecting from the tomb of Humayun, which was built in 1569 at Delhi by Akbar. Jahangir's greatest contribution was laying out the large formal garden which adorned many cities of Kashmir, that Shalimar and Nishat garden that still exist in Srinagar, near to Srinagar, and in Punjab. The Mughal garden is a regular arrangement of a square, artificial pools with numerous fountain from an important part of the plan. Jahangir's beautiful mausoleum at Shahadra near Lahore was probably planned by Emperor himself, but it was completed in the next reign by his widow Noor Jahan, decorated by inlaid marbles, glazed tiles and painted patterns. The style of Shah Jahan's principal edifices is basically Persian, but is distinguished by the lavish use of white marble and minute and tasteful decoration. Among the most famous of his building are the Pearl Mosque, or which we called Moti Masjid, and the Taj Mahal of Agra, and then the Red Fort at Agra and Jama Masjid at Delhi. Humayun, who founded the Mughal school of painting, it's developed under Akbar, who organized it with his usual zeal, but it's reached on its climax during Jahangir. Jahangir, best known painter, were Aga Raza of Herat and his son Abul Hasan, the Kalmuk artist Farukh Beg, Muhammad Nadir and Muhammad Murad, both of Samarkand, Ustad Mansur, the leading animal painter, Bishandas, Manohar and Govardhan. Regarding Jahangir, what he said in his memoir, he was able to make difference in one painting, even if 10 painters are working on one painting, he was unable to make difference which part of the painting was made by which painter. So he was so keenly observed the painting of his period, and he himself was very much interested in painting. Mughal patronized music lavishly, and in this Akbar led the way. Abul Fazl gave the names of nearly 40 prominent musicians and instrumentalists who flourished at the court of Akbar. Tansen was the most famous musician of the period. Music received great encouragement under Shah Jahan. While he had 30 prominent musicians and instrumentalists at his court, who were generously rewarded for good performance. Aurangzeb had himself studied music, but his deepening Puritanism led him to abandon it from religious ground. it abandon it on a religious ground. It's very interesting to note Aurangzeb, who did not allow music in his court, but at the same time music was continuing in royal harem. And there is one important information I would like to share with you. Aurangzeb himself was very good player of Bina. In 1688, Aurangzeb disbanded the large band of musicians attached to the royal court, but it was continued in the royal harem. During Aurangzeb's reign, music ceased to enjoy royal patronage. One of the most famous Indo-Muslim books was the Rag Darpan, the Mirror of Music, written by Fakirullah, who was one time governor of Kashmir. Music reached to the climax under the Mughal King Muhammad Shah, who is also known as Muhammad Shah Rangila because of his special attention, special interest in music. Now, development of language and literature. Among biographical works, Babur autobiography, originally written in Turkish but soon translated into elegant Persian by Abdul Rahim Khan Khana, is the best. Persian was the language of Mughal intellectual life and it was the official language of Mughal period also. Large number of prominent Irani poets including Urfi, Naziri, Talib and Kalim migrated to India and enrolled under Mughals. Faizi, whose genius matured before the large-scale immigration of poets from Iran and the introduction of new school of poetry, was the brother of Abul Fazl. Abul Fazl, who comprehensive Akbarnama and Ain-e-Akbari, was the most important works produced in India. Badayuni, a master of the telling phrases and capable of evoking a living picture with a few deft strokes, was another scholar working under Akbar. Among Hindu, the greatest Hindi poet of Akbar day was famous Tulsidas, whose career was spent far from the worldly court. He was staying in Ayodhya, that too in a masjid, and he wrote wonderful book that what we call it Ramcharitramanas, that is popular among the religious people who do believe in Hindu religion. Akbar courtier Raja Birbal was the Kaviraj, a skillful writer in Hindi. Abdul Rahim furthered the development of language by extending his patronage to a number of other poets who used it. The title of Kaviraj continued to be conferred even in Aurangzeb time and during his son, who ascended the throne with the title Bahadur Shah. He also patronized Hindi literature. Urdu literature systematically nourished in the south by the Sufi saints and Dakani king. Nusrati, a poet attached to the court of Bijapur, wrote Masnavi in a language remote from modern Urdu but within its tradition. The first collection of Urdu lyrics was written by Sultan Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah, the king of Golconda and founder of the city of Hyderabad. Modern Urdu poetry really began with Wali. He blended the Dakani and Gujarati idioms with polite and more sophisticated language of the north. He also translated Urdu poetry ideas and images with which readers of Persian poetry were familiar, and thus enriched Urdu could replace Persian poetry with the 18th century onwards. So in this module, the module which related with the society and culture, we discuss about the rituals, festivals, architectural development, development in painting, that to the progress which took place during Jahangir. Then we discuss about the development of literature, the patronage which was given by Akbar and that was continued up to Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb was the man who discontinued the writing history during his period. But even then, there was a lot of Persian books that was written during the Mughal period because Persian was the official language of India. Similarly, regarding the position of women, what we discussed, there was no further progress in the condition and status of women. Whatever it was earlier during the Sultanate period, it was almost the same. Maybe because they don't have economic right, there was a parda system, then they were not allowed to remarry, system of sati was there. We have the reference of Johar also during the Mughal period. Now we have discussed about the rituals in this module, which were performed by the Hindus and the Muslim family. Then there was a rituals related with the marriages during the Muslim and between the Hindu and Muslim the rituals which was performed by Hindu and Muslim at the time of marriages. We discuss about the outdoor games, which was mainly popular among the ruling class, hunting was one of the most important pastime, and most of the ruler, including Jahangir or Akbar, they all used to go on hunting. Then the elephant fighting, pigeon fighting, this was the method through which people used to pass their time, as they do not have internet facility as we have in 21st centuries. For the society and culture, if you wanted to learn more, then you are advised to refer the e-text which are available on EPG Pathshala and the reference book. Thank you very much.